experiment, which is muscle memory. And so I need all of you to be really involved and help me out and take your right leg and stick it out in front of you and make clockwise circles, circles that are clockwise, and keep going with the clockwise circles. Take your right hand and stick it out and draw the number 6. And then look down at your leg. So now, is your brain controlling your body, or is your body in charge, or are you in charge? That's the question. I'm going to juggle for you on stage, which I've never done on stage before. Now you need to look at this. I know how people do that and talk at the same time. It's just muscle memory. Well, it turns out muscles are really dumb. You're not training your muscles when you're learning how to juggle. What you're training is your brain. And ask any neuroscientist, and they'll tell you the number one way to increase the neuronal connections transhemisphere, cross from side to side, and increase the synapses that connect those neurons is to learn how to juggle. Like, it's noticeable differences in your brain within 7 days if you try to learn how to juggle. It's a lot of fun. I recommend it. But the question that you might be asking is, if I do that, will it make me happy? And the other question is, if I can train my arms how to juggle, can I train my brain how to make me happy? And it turns out that you can. And we even have some data. Some researchers at Harvard decided that they didn't have a lot of good data about happiness, and so they went out and built an app for that. They had thousands of people download the app, they had millions of data points, and basically the app worked like this. They would ping you a couple of times a day and say, are you happy right now, and what are you doing? So the things that they were doing broke down into 17 categories. The least popular, the least happy activity was working. It went all the way up to the number one activity, which I left the name off of because I was building this slide deck with my 10-year-old son. But you can imagine the activity that makes you the most happy. So throwing that one out, the range of activities there really wasn't that much difference. There was only about 15 points difference between the worst, working, and the very best activity, which was exercising. So they realized there was so little differential that they needed more information. So they started asking another question. The other question that they asked was, while you were doing what you're doing, was your mind wandering, or were you focused on what you were doing? And so if your mind was wandering on unpleasant thoughts, well, no surprise, you weren't very happy. If your mind was wandering with neutral thoughts, it was neutral. If you were having pleasant thoughts, you were doing pretty happy, you would be pretty happy. The most interesting one is the bottom. If your mind was not wandering, if you were focused on what you were doing, you were happier even than when you were mind wandering and being happy with the mind wandering. That is, if you're doing something that you don't like, if you're focused on it, you're going to be happier than if your mind was wandering. So let's go back to that activity that left the name off. Think about it. It's controlled a lot by the old reptilian part of the brain. It kind of shuts off the whole prefrontal cortex. Your mind isn't wandering a lot when you're involved in this activity. And so that's part of what makes it so great, and it's part of what makes anything great if you can really focus on it. So let's try that actually right now. Let's have a really kind of bonding between us right now, really consummate this relationship, and see if we're happier at the end of it, okay? Is that all right? Now, all right, so that's it. That's how to be happy for you, right? Focus on what you're doing, and you'll be happier for it. How do you get happiness to others from you? And for this, we're going to do a little experiment called Name That Tune. I'm going to have to come down here and ask for a volunteer. Anybody here have any kind of musical training, play the drums, sing the church choir, anything like that? Or when are you willing to help us out, David, just really quickly? Oh, okay, good. I didn't know. All right, so this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask David to tap out a song. And when he taps out the song, you're going to try to recognize that song. But as he's tapping it out, don't shout out. Don't say, oh, I know that song, right? Just let him tap it out, and then we'll see what happens after that. Everybody in the room knows this song. All right, go ahead and tap. All right, very good. Let's hear it for David. All right, now, before we get the responses from the people in the audience, how many people, I got one up here because I got through it. How many people do you think in the audience will know what that song is based on your excellent drumming?
Are you asking me?
Yeah, what do you think? What's the percent?
80%.
That's in the range. There was a researcher at Stanford that did this exact experiment, and what she found was that about, the estimate was about 47%, the average of all the estimates was about half. People thought that about half of the people would be able to recognize the song based on the drumming.
Right. How many people, raise your hand, think you know what the song was? You're there. What do you think the song is?
Happy Birthday.
Happy Birthday. Anybody else? What do you think it was?
Star Spangled Banner.
Star Spangled Banner. Hey, there's somebody who actually got it right. How many people thought it was the Star Spangled Banner? That's consistent with her findings, too. About 2.5% of the people actually thought that they were able to recognize what the song was. Why is that, right? Because the thing that's in our heads is not in the heads of the people that are listening. If he had said, hey, here's the Star Spangled Banner, hum along, and then tap it out, it would have been 100%. And so that's the funny little message that has to do with our brains. How to get to be happy, how to have a way of having happiness for you is to get the ideas into the hands of other people. And the way that you do that is you have to tell them. Don't send an email with a subject line like hi or stuff. Put in the subject line what you're talking about. Give people what's in your head just by talking to them. It's a huge trick, and believe me, it makes a big difference. All right, so that was our second trick. Let's move on to our third one really quickly. Happiness for you from others. All right, this is our last interactive experiment. It has to do with all the little sticky notes that are in front of you. This is how it's going to work. This is the great city of Milwaukee. I'm going to ask the people that have a gray sticky note near them to grab the sticky note and stand up and face the back of the room so that you can't see the monitors, because I'm going to show us something to this part of the audience that doesn't get to see it. Everybody with the gray sticky notes, face the other side. Thank you. Face backwards, face backwards, face backwards. All right, very good. All right, so for the people with yellow sticky notes, I want you to look at the screen and look at this question. All right, can everybody see this question? All right, now you don't have to think a lot about it. Just grab one of the yellow sticky notes and write your estimate down on the piece of paper. All right, people with the gray, you can turn back towards the front, sit down, and grab your gray sticky note. So while the yellow people are writing down just your best estimate, write it down on the piece of paper, and then pass it towards the outside. And then Travis and David, our special assistants, are going to come with microphones that we hope are turned on. Where's Andre? Okay, here's the microphone. All right. And we need two. All right, now for the people with the gray, so everybody's written down their number on the yellow sticky notes. You've got your number written down. All right, for the people with the gray sticky notes, here is your question. Take a look at this. Do your best job. Just write down an estimate of what you think the population is. Write it down, and then pass it down towards the outside. Okay? You guys doing that? Write it down, pass it down, or do you borrow a pen or pencil to do that? All right, now what I get the people on the aisle to do is to do a quick average of all the people from your row of what your estimate was for the population of Milwaukee, okay? So if you've got a quick estimate, Travis, go ahead.
You have 1 million.
1 million.
500,000.
500,000. And just real quick average, what was it?
3.8196.
3.8196, all right, keep going down.
Million.
3 million.
3 million?
2 million.
2 million?
This one.
800,000.
800,000. All right, let's do the yellow note sticky side. What's your average? Or the gray note sticky side, sorry.
375,000.
375?
400,000.
400?
560.
Okay.
750,000.
Okay.
The
800, okay. All right, so we had some good guesses here. Maybe people saw. Go ahead.
870,000.
870,000. So, oh, do we have a couple more?
400,000.
400?
800,000.
So, it looks like the average, if we were to take a quick average of this side and a quick average of this side, it looks like this side was probably averaged out at about 1.5 million, maybe 2 million. We had a couple of high ones, and then this one was substantially less than a million. So just by this little trick that we did here, we took about 1 million people away from the city of Milwaukee, which is a pretty cool trick. So what's the trick we're using? It's called anchoring. And I'm going to do one more little just explanation of that. This is the Sistine Chapel. This is where I first came up with this idea. The place when I go for lunch, I used to have a trivia question every day, and the question was, how many years did it take to paint the Sistine Chapel? And I asked the guy what the average, what the answers were, and he said, you know, most of the people have been answering 16. I thought, 16? Why are they answering 16? The Sistine Chapel. It doesn't even have to be a number. Next time you want to go like to your boss and get a raise, before you start talking about how much of a raise you want, just open up the papers. Wow, look at that. 30 to 50% chance of rain tomorrow. 30 to 50%. Imagine that. And then go on and ask for a raise. Okay, now we have fun. If you might just want to do a quick tweet, this is me and this is my company. If you want some research, I'd be happy to send you the sources on the research that came up with this. Send it out to scoutblogmap.com, and thank you very much.